Okay, so All Is One basically represents a very epic front cover with the three monotheistic religions' symbols into a one logo. Very epic, very in a way of representing utopia in a very strong way. Of course, the album name, All Is One, it's a very strong, dreamy statement. And literally, the album and what happens within the album and the lyrics is the complete opposite of what's going on in the front cover. And now I will make a track by track and explain to you guys about each and every one of the tracks. So the album starts with a very uplifting song, All Is One, and that's some kind of an oriental metal hymn that we did for the Middle Eastern metal fans. The heavy metal fans in the Middle East, they are an amazing people who struggle in ways that people in Europe or in the USA cannot imagine, because those people are having society problems. They are persecuted by religious people, by society. Everyone consider them to be a complete freaks. Just imagine people who are wearing a slayer t-shirt, long hair and tattoos in Egypt or in Syria. They are immediately considered as freaks, Satanists, or you name it. And those metal fans from the Middle East, for me, they are the most amazing metal fans in the whole world. Because they are brave. They are living in very hard countries that not accepting them. And Orphan Land, as a band who comes from the Middle East and as pioneers of the Oriental metal genre, I think that those metal fans are the ones that really made me believe so many things about the country, about the Middle East, about them. And this track, in a way, is dedicated to them. It's like a hymn for the whole Oriental metal fans out there. On the other hand, it deals with the fact that as human beings, despite the fact that we are all one, we always fail to see that. And it doesn't matter what are we going through or what are the things that we are about, we always fail to see that all is one. That is also one of the things on that song. Second song is called The Simple Man. Basically, I wrote it after people used to tell me many times that I look like Jesus Christ, and it turned into some kind of a joke where I always went to live shows dressed up like Jesus Christ, and then I had to tell the audience that I'm not really Jesus Christ. So it's mainly telling the story about a guy who is having these abilities to be a leader and to he have that charisma so he can take a lot of people after him as a shepherd. But on the other hand, he's just a simple man. And that's a message that I want to send to people. In our world, we tend to follow people with charisma or people who have abilities of shepherds. But the thing is that each and every one of us is the shepherd, and we need to still be simple men and stay as simple men. It doesn't matter how much I will succeed with the band or whatever success we will have. My only aim is to stay a simple man, because those simple men of the world, they are the people that I trust the most. They are the hope of this world, the people who are not brainwashed, who are not trapped. They're just simple men. And that's about that song. Third song, Brother, is a very interesting song. It's a letter that Isaac is writing to Ishmael. Isaac and Ishmael were both the sons of Abraham in the Bible, and all Arabs consider themselves to be the sons of Ishmael, while all the Israelites, the Jews, consider themselves to be the sons of Isaac. There is a conflict that starts right there back in the days where Isaac and Ishmael's mothers are having this conflict between them. So we believe that maybe the conflict between Israelis and Arabs even started back then, on the early days of the Bible, between Ishmael and Isaac. So this is a letter from Isaac to Ishmael, in a way telling him that he miss him, and that maybe they can work this out, maybe they can create a realm of light. There is a very interesting thing on that song, is that you can see how people shape reality or history in the way they want it for themselves. And I'll give you an example. There is a story in Judaism that it says that Abraham took Isaac to the mountain and wanted to sacrifice him to God. There is the same story in Islam, where Isaac took Ishmael into the mountain and wanted to sacrifice him to God. So every religion took a story and reshaped it to their own benefit, and God only knows what was the truth. So in that song we have a phrase saying, the Lord blessed us both, but we still fight and claim that kid on the mountain, what was his name? I think it's a great ballad, and it's a great love story between two brothers. Despite the whole conflict of thousands of years, it's still a declaration of one of the brothers. I represent Isaac. I'm an Israelite, I'm from Israel. So it's definitely a declaration of love to my brother Ishmael. Despite all the conflicts, despite everything, Jews and Arabs are forgetting that they are historically brothers. The hate is so strong, the brainwash is so strong, that they simply cannot remember it. It's out of their mind and brain that we are literally brothers. We share the same names. The Jews say Avraham, Arabs say Ibrahim. For what you guys say Joseph, we say Yosef, they say Yusuf. We even share the same names. So it's a very strong family connection that for some reason turned into a bloodshed. And so that is the song Brother, and it's a great ballad. Let the truth be known. This is again, in a way, a story that the two brothers are meeting each other, but a thousand years later, on a battlefield, they meet each other as two soldiers from the two sides of the war. And it is inspired from a story that happened in World War I, where there was a story about the Christmas truce. For one night, the Germans and the British were celebrating Christmas and stopped fighting each other and started to hear each other's songs from the other side. They were so drunk that they started to go towards each other, and for one night on no man's land they celebrated together, drank together, switched presents, hugged each other, kissed each other, jumped together. For one night you had a utopia and a dream of the human spirit raising above any conflict, and then the next day they went back to kill each other. My mind was fucked from that story, because it's an amazing story and it's a tragic story on the other hand. So I decided to write that song about that conflict between two soldiers who are fighting each other, but at night, when they are hiding from each other, one of the soldiers is listening, the other one playing a flute, and he knows the melody of the song, so he starts to sing the melody. And after they're doing that, they start to walk towards each other, and then, like that story, they just spend the night together and talk to each other all night, and understand that they are actually brothers trapped in a war, that they don't really know the purpose of it. Then the next morning, each and every one of them is going back to base, because they're still soldiers in a war. And then the next night, when they bumped into each other again, they just shoot before they noticed. And only when they fell down into the ground, they saw that they literally killed each other. And that's the tragedy of our region. Even if the human spirit is raising for one moment, you're still trapped in this turmoil of blood, and that tragedy still wins and evil still prevails, despite of all the hope and everything. Fifth song, True Fire and Water, it's one of the most optimistic songs on the album. It's in Hebrew and Arabic, and it's basically like a love story that says that despite the love, the war and the bloodshed, through fire and water, I will go with you, because that is love. If we should define love, so love is saying that despite all the difficulties and the brother and the conflicts and the bloodshed, love will still be bonded and go through fire and water. And that's what that song is all about. I deliberately wrote it in Hebrew and Arabic. And there is a guest on that song. It's a Palestinian singer called Mira Awad. So it's great to have an Israeli and a Palestinian singing in Hebrew and Arabic on a love song, despite all the war and the bloodshed that you had on the previous two tracks before. In a way, that love is some kind of euphoria, because it's very hard to a love like that to exist in the Middle East. So the song ends on a very big surprise and switch, and it switched immediately to the song Fail, like a slap in the face. Starts the song Fail, which is like a manifest of why do we fail to see that all is one, and it's a very angry manifest about the media, about politicians, about religious leaders, about the way that we are so brainwashed and following every idiot with a sip of charisma can just take us and we will follow him. Because we are so uneducated, we are so followers of the media, we are so followers of rabbis and imams and politicians, that we will just walk as sheeps who walk towards their death. And so that's a huge manifest on that song, and it's like a twist song of the album. It's exactly the middle of the album, and that's the only song where I growl on the album. I didn't thought I will growl on that album, but the song was so angry that I thought that it would be great to growl. So there is a great lyrics on that song. It's a complete different song from the rest, and probably one of the strongest lyrics wise songs of the album. Freedom is an instrumental song, and it just fits to be on that spot, because after all those tragedies, euphoria and angry manifests, sometimes you just want to breathe. You just want to breathe, you just want to feel freedom. So that's what it is. 3 minutes of complete freedom. Song number 8 is Shamaim. Shamaim was written to us by an Israeli artist called Yehuda Poliker. Yehuda Poliker is one of the most famous Israeli songwriters. He's a great, great artist, and he's some kind of idol, mentor, father artist for Orphanland. We took the name Orphanland when we saw those two words in one of his songs on the 90s. And even our music is very much inspired from him. When we filmed the DVD in 2010, he was a guest on the DVD, and we played 4 songs with him. It was a great experience for us, and we kept in touch ever since, and he was contacting us and offered to write us a song. Of course, for us it was the great privilege of the world to have our idol writing us a song. We immediately said yes, and he wrote a song in Hebrew that in a way described the situation of the Middle East and Israel on his own melancholic kind of a way. He wrote it in a perfect way that he actually made a sculpture of lyrics of what is Orphanland, and he's so accurate, and he just did it on a perfect way. The song is in Hebrew, but there is an English translation as well, so it will be easy for fans all over to understand the lyrics and to get this amazing song by Yehuda Poliker and us. The next one is a song in Yemenite, some kind of a mixture between Hebrew and Arabic Yemenite root, and it's also a song that it's Yemenite is some kind of in a way it's a song that similar to Sapari in a way, because Sapari is also a Yemenite song. So this one is a song who was written also by an Israeli artist called Aaron Amram, and Aaron Amram is a well-known Israeli artist, a great Yemenite artist. Shlomit Levi, our former female singer, she always used to take motifs from his songs and she used to combine them in Mabul and in Or Warrior, and at one stage we took his two sons as guests in one of our shows, and it was a great show together with them, and we decided to cover one of their father's songs. The sons of Aaron Amram is also singing in that song, and it's a great performance and it's a great folklore song. Highly recommended for people who like to party with us. Our Own Messiah. That's a very strong song because it just asks a simple question. How can it be that we pray for so many years and decades and centuries? Pray and pray and pray. Everyone with his own God, we just pray for God. Waiting for some Messiah, but nothing happened. People still kill each other. War are still prevailing everywhere. People are still dying everywhere. Poverty and bloodshed is still going everywhere. It's not only a Middle Eastern problem. And we still keep on praying and praying and praying to a God that never answers and never fixes the situation. So the song deals with that situation. Why do we do that? Why don't we educate ourselves to solve the problem? Why don't we figure out that if there is a Messiah, it's probably not Jesus Christ. It's probably not, I don't know, anyone else. It's probably us. And the way, if we will educate ourselves to stop listening to news and stop listening to all these leaders and all these religious leaders, just listen to ourselves and find a way to fix it, like we do it with our fans very easily. Maybe that's the only Messiah that we can find in this world. And that's the topic of that song. Children is probably the most tragic song that Orphanland ever wrote. When we wrote it, we thought about the children of Syria, but it's dedicated to children who are trapped between fire everywhere. The situation where children are trapped in fire and the adult one are just throwing bombs at each other and being more children than any other child in the world, that's a tragic situation that I cannot accept. And we're coming from a region where children are literally suffering. If it's in Israel, if it's in Syria, if it's in Gaza, the children are innocent and they are suffering because we, the adult one, cannot fix the situation. We cannot solve it. So this song is dedicated to them. It's a very tragic song. It's written from the eyes and voice of a child who is trying to ask those questions, why does that happening? And the strongest question is that the child is asking in his parents, must I grow to be like you? Because whatever happened is that we are inspired from our parents and we are becoming like our parents at the end. And that's why that loop never ends. It's a circle of blood that never ends. Those children are innocent, but if they survive, they grow to be like their parents.